So what we're about to do, Periscope was never invented to do, all right? But we're having fun with it. And thanks for hanging in there. All right, let me turn the music down because we got a good night planned for you. Right over here on my left, ladies and gentlemen, this is great. This is so cool. Look, he's enjoying, he's loving it already. Right there, ladies and gentlemen, the founder, the director, the CEO, the president, the prime minister of At You Too. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Matt McGee. And something changed. What changed? Let me see that. Oh, there we go. It's just the reflection on the screen. So allow me to make one adjustment here. I got to take a couple of YouTube books out, lower it a little bit, and we'll angle it off, and everybody's going to – we're going to fall now. There we go. There we go. Are you checking out Matt's shirt? Hey, that's what he wants you to see. There you go, Matt's shirt. What does it say, Matt?
It says, on the eighth day, God created you two.
I'm going to get an amen.
Amen.
All right. There we go. I think now we're looking pretty good. I get it. I see what's happening here. I'm going to try one more thing. See, this is always a work in progress, folks. We're always trying to make Periscope do something that it was never designed to do. So if you Periscope guys are out there, this is what we want. We want the ability to have a two-way conversation and get everybody else in on chat. How's that looking? That's pretty good. You know, that's about as good looking as I've ever seen Matt McGee get, in fact. There we go.
It's as good as it's going to look with me in the screen, that's for sure.
I knew that was coming. All right, everybody hearing okay? Can you guys hear? Give me a 1 to 5. How's the broadcast tonight? Are you hearing? Are you seeing it okay? Can you get Matt in there? All right. 5 being the best, of course. Nice. If any of you are having trouble with glitchiness and everything, about 2-3 weeks ago, maybe at the most, Periscope came out with an update, and they promised to get rid of some of that glitchiness so you could try the update on your app. Or what a bunch of us have been doing lately is we've been watching on our computer, and we've been commenting on a device. So we got a lot of multiple simultaneous users out there doing different things. So they're kind of getting around the system that way too. You could use Safari or you can use Chrome. Can't use Internet Explorer. They just don't have it designed for that right now. So that's some ways to do what we're doing. This is called the Crystal Ballroom. We're a little chat community built around you two and fandom, but we go deeper than the fangirl thing. We're actually trying to get some serious content and talk about all the wonderful stuff that you two does and about the activism and about the concert tour that they're in right now with Innocence and Experience. Is anybody new out there? Type in new real quick if you're new to the Crystal Ballroom, and we'd love to say hi to you. Everybody will say hi to you. It's a great family. It's a great tribe here. So anybody new out there? We got a few new people. All right. Hi, Mark Court and Flay Dog. Good to see you all. And Flynn, Scott. And I'm not knocking fangirls, music girl. Come on. See, every time I say something like that, then I get in trouble. And Sir Barry and Deb from NC. JT, knock it off, you goober. All right. Soul Drifter, not new. See, now you're just trying to get a shout out, you guys. You're pretty smart. See, one thing that you two has always said from the beginning is they have a smart audience. And we'll do it, man. We'll do it. All right. This is called the Crystal Ballroom. We got Matt McGee from At You Two on tonight. Last week we had, how many of you were here to hear Big Wave John from U2.com? That was pretty cool, eh? You're here to hear John? Give him a shout out. He was, you know, he's in England and he was going to try to make it tonight. I don't think I've seen him, but he was at the Greenbelt Festival all weekend and said he needed some sleep, so he might not make it. And then a week before Big Wave was Beth and Bono and Chris LeClaire, and they've been following the tour and they're doing a great project. They've been on our podcast, right, Matt?
Yes, they were.
Was it last week's podcast?
Same week that you had them on.
That's funny.
On Crystal Ballroom.
Yeah,
right?
They're famous. They're beautiful people. And then 3 weeks ago, we had the amazing YouTube brother,
Good old Mark.
Good old Mark. He was here with us, and he was telling some great stories from his treks and his journeys with you two as well. So it's been quite a month. See, all of you were dreading this month because, you know, you two wasn't going to be performing. And I said, we're working on something. We'll keep you going. And just by chance, it landed on Monday nights, and the Crystal Ballroom has evolved. All right, we're going to get right to it. We know that a bunch of you are going to have questions, and we're glad for those. We'll take some questions later. Jot down a few notes. We're going to be talking through a range of topics. We'd love to, you already got the tattoo conversation going on in the background. Perfect. No problem. Matt and I aren't offended. This is a little portal into the world of YouTube fandom. We're just glad that you guys have all joined. Talk about whatever you want to talk about. The thing that I'm really surprised about is we just don't get many trollers in this little environment. I guess we're boring to them or something. Like, who trolls you too? I don't know.
Radiohead fans.
There you go. That's hilarious. Pearl Jam fans, yeah. The Deadheads.
Tweet out your link.
Did the link not tweet again? Oh, man, that's too bad. Everybody tweet out the link. You guys just go tweet out the link. You know what? Can I do it? Yeah, I can if I do it from my iPad. I don't understand why that – it used to be on default to tweet out. It did not, and
– this is excuses.
I know. I'm so sorry, Matt. It's not you. Don't take it personally.
That's all right. You don't want too many viewers tonight. I don't blame you either.
All right. How many characters do I have? I got minus 14.
Too long, it didn't go out.
I know. We're getting there. Okay. It's the Crystal Ballroom. I got to figure out how many characters I can use. There we go. And boom, Twitterverse.
There we go.
You now have it.
I can retweet it from at you too.
Yeah, and you know, okay, that's great. And anybody can just kind of swipe and retweet as well.
There you go.
Thanks, gang. Oh, hey, look at that. At you too retweeted. How great. Hey, did we see any of our you too staff out there? I didn't know if Sherry was going to be like live tweeting from the Crystal Ballroom tonight or what.
Yes, I think she's. Sherry already tweeted out my T-shirt.
Oh, good. she'll be screenshotting your T-shirt, and it'll make its way out there. So, all right. Well, enough chit chatting. All right. Oh, there's Sherry. Hi, Sherry.
There, you guys pose for a screenshot.
Okay, screenshot, Matt. Look straight into. There you go. Somebody grab it, quick. I know you're doing it. There's enough of you out there. Okay, good. You got it. That's your last chance. As you can tell, Matt and I just know each other a little too well, and we're just kind of in our own little...
That's dangerous.
This is
so
like
dangerous.
The crystalline ballroom over here or something, and you guys are just welcome to it. But, okay. Yo, we're getting there. Look at the flames are starting already, Matt, and we're going to just wait till later in the broadcast to get there, but... Oh, my goodness. Matt, let's talk about At You Too, because this is fascinating. We just celebrated the 20th anniversary. I've been hanging out with you maybe 5 years now, 6 years or something. Maybe not that long. But you gave a call out, a shout out during the Vertigo tour. Was it in between Vertigo and 360 maybe that I know? Well, actually, I applied. Yeah, you gave a shout out and I applied. Like maybe 8 years ago, and you denied me. You denied. You remember that, of course. I wasn't good enough for At You Too. So if any of you others have been denied, just hang in there. Wait your turn. So I've been writing now with At You Too. Something about you liked one of my ideas or something like that. It didn't have anything to do with Periscope, actually. I've been working with you now for a few years, and we've been hanging out, but you have a much, much, much longer history with this thing, and I totally, you know, on one hand, I get that, and I honor that, and I respect that, but I just haven't been around as long as you. 20 years, we celebrated. Oh, we're not going to mention the party.
Nope, not allowed.
Okay, no, we're not going to talk about the party tonight, but we did have a celebration, a 20-year anniversary not too long ago. You might want to look that up on our website. There were a few special guests there. And
yes.
What you did at that celebration is you just kind of told a little bit about the history of the site, which Maybe I'm the only one who thought so because I get to work with you now. And we're all volunteer, by the way. None of us are getting paid. We don't know the band. We don't get tickets, you know, and all that kind of thing. So, Matt, where did this all come from? Where did this whole at YouTube thing with tens of thousands of followers and fans and tweets and celebrations and all that kind of thing? Tell us about the beginning, man.
Well, yeah, every fan needs a way to, you know, express their fandom, I guess. Like, some picked all the collectibles and the records and, you know, have, you know, these incredible shrines and all that sort of stuff. And, you know, some fans go around and follow the tour around. And, you know, every fan, I think, just has a different way that they express their fandom. And so for me, it was just, you know, I was very into the internet around 1995 and decided to start a website for my favorite bands, which happened to be at that time U2, REM, and I think the third one was Toad the Wet Sprocket. Does anybody remember Toad the Wet Sprocket?
Nice.
Yes. They had a fantastic video for a song called Something's Always Wrong. Wonderful song. Anyway, so I started the website and about my favorite musical bands, and that lasted for you know, like 2 or 3 months, and then I was active. I was very active at that time, and there was a U2 community on AOL. There was a U2 community on CompuServe, and, of course, there was the Wire mailing list.
Yeah.
And so just being around other, you know, fans, U2 fans online, it was pretty quick that the website shifted to being just about at U2. So it was probably, you know, 2 or 3 months that you know, there was REM and other content there, and then it just became an all at YouTube website, and then we were kind of off and running at that point.
Oh, how funny. So I was just going to, that's what I was going to ask is, you know, was that like a CompuServe thing, or was that one of those AOL communities? Is that the way it started? I mean, AOL, my goodness. Every once in a while I see somebody with an AOL email address now, and it's like, you know, it's like
Sherry Lawrence.
Oops. So you were like 10 years old when you started this thing, right? You were a 10-year-old prodigy sitting in a dark, dismal basement somewhere of your parents' house, eating nothing but Oreos and drinking Pepsi or something.
Yes, that's exactly. I was 10 years old. So I wish. My wife and I were married 4 years at the time, and we had a tiny little one-bedroom apartment in Kennewick, Washington, and I had a Macintosh Performa 450,
Wow. Which
had probably one-hundredth the computing power of today's iPhone, and cost probably 10 times today's iPhone.
Oh, man.
And so, yeah, I didn't use AOL or CompuServe or anything to start the website. It was hosted at the same place it's hosted. I mean, my gosh, yeah, that's the website's hosted the same company now, which is you know, an ISP here in Tri-Cities, Washington.
Well, you chose wisely, man. That was a good move.
Yes, seriously.
Yeah, so remind us, though, what was internet and computer culture like in 1996, right? Was it 5 or 6? Yeah, 6.
Well, it was 1994 is when I first got online and found the CompuServe community and the AOL community. And I think it's probably something that a lot of the Crystal Ballroom people can relate to, because I remember going into the AOL boards, which, you know, this massive, you know, like sort of a mix between a forum and a live chat room kind of thing. And people were talking to each other and posting messages back and forth. And it was like I had found my bee people. Right? Like, this was, I finally found my tribe, my community. You know, growing up, I think a lot of fans can probably relate to this, because, you know, you're the biggest U2 fan in your circles. And so there's so much you want to say and talk about and analyze and all this sort of stuff. But there was nobody that I could, you know, share these things with until I found these online boards. And then it was just like the doors opened up and I was like, oh, my gosh, these are my people. Let's talk. And it was just, I mean, it was heaven. It was, you know, I was on there constantly. So.
And talking was kind of forum based, right? Was it message board forum-based?
Yeah, it was leaving messages back and forth and all that sort of stuff. So it was mostly similar to what you would think of today with forum, yeah.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I remember the old boards where we'd get on and we'd create a topic. I wasn't necessarily into the U2 forums at that point, but yeah, we'd kind of create a topic and then somebody would moderate it. You'd talk back and forth, but it's quite cumbersome actually too.
Yeah. Well, and then there was the wire mailing list too, which was easier in the sense that it was all done via email. So you just get this flow of messages throughout the day, where you could subscribe to the digest format,
one per day,
huge message at the end of the day, and it was just fantastic to have all of these other U2 fans around the world suddenly that you can talk with and share things with and not be embarrassed about how big of a big U2 geek that you are.
Yeah. How many were, I'm just looking at the crowd now, I wonder how many of you in Periscope world right now were a part of like a CompuServe or an AOL, kind of a list like that or a forum way back in the day. I certainly wasn't. I wasn't even aware of kind of a global U2 community or something like that. So we got a bunch of faithful kind of diehards in the crowd right here. And of course,
1993, wow.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. And we were probably all using dial-up at that point, right? Yeah, we would have. kind of a thing. And it was just, so what, 20, here we are 20 years out and we just laugh at that technology. I keep asking myself, what in even 5 years will we say? Remember when we all huddled around our devices and we searched for a video stream of the concert or something, or we listened to Sill broadcasting the Roxy? Remember when we all sat around the device and I can't even imagine what we'll say in 5 years, let alone 10 or 20 years from now. Pretty cool.
It's crazy how the technology just continues to. I remember on the Elevation tour, was the first tour they opened in Miami, as I recall, and that was the first tour where, going back, obviously At U2 was online for the Pop Mart tour, and at that point it was you'd figure out the set list by couple hours after the show, if you were lucky enough to have somebody on wire post that was at the show, get home and post the set list, or you get it the next day from somebody. And then by Elevation Tour is when a couple people would have cell phones. And so I remember getting a couple calls during the Elevation Tour from
listen
people
to this.
Trying to let me listen into the show. And the audio quality was just terrible.
Yeah.
And but the Elevation Tour, we, for opening night in Miami, I think it was, we actually posted something similar to what we do now on Twitter. We did that right on the homepage of At U2, where every time somebody would call in, with a new song, we'd say, "Oh, they're playing this song now," and we'd update the At U2 homepage with that. So that was Elevation Tour. By the time the Vertigo Tour rolled around, things were starting to get much more closer to real time because cell phones were more popular then. And obviously, then on the last tour on 360, there were some people live streaming, and then this tour, everybody's live streaming. So it's incredible how it's changed.
Yeah, very cool. So help everybody understand where you're at with starting At U2, kind of in perspective with U2.com and that whole timeline as well.
Well, U2.com didn't launch until, I think it was August of 2000, and it launched. Well, there was a U2 website on Island Records in the late 1990s that I believe was online, and then they sort of relaunched it to promote the best of 1980 to 1990. And then U2.com came online in the summer of 2000, a couple months before All That You Can't Leave Behind. And so we were online, 4 or 5 years by then. And it was interesting to watch, to finally have a formal website for the band at
official.
That point. I don't think it really changed much of how we were doing things at that time though.
Yeah, cool. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give a big shout out and a big clap for Matt McGee for thinking of atu.com 5 years before U2.com itself was out there. No offense, U2.com. You guys are great. We love you, man. And We have So part of what's happened in just even in the last 6 months or so is we've really kind of, I don't know, is there a friendship that's emerged with U2.com? It's really been fun to see how they've supported some of the things some of the fan sites are doing with their social stream and with some of the things they're tweeting out. Even John Big Wave was just kind enough to tweet out, you know, the little Crystal Ballroom here, and just that we would both be on together.
Yeah, it was. I was. I think we all were. Tim, you backed me up on this. I think we were all, just to use one example, thrilled to see that they went out of their way to post something on the website on YouTube.com after our party, right? That they certainly didn't need to do that. It was, wasn't news that, the whole world needed to know about. It was something really cool that the band members did, obviously, but, they made it about our party and about our 20th anniversary. That's really nice. As opposed to about, yeah, what, those two party crashers did.
Yeah.
It was very generous on their part. And they spread the word about it on their social channels and all that sort of stuff. And it was very, 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 very cool.
And we'd like to say thanks again in case anybody's out there. We were just incredibly honored, and we don't take that trust for granted, right? That was a lot of fun. Hey, my wife Tracy is right here, and she's going to poke her head in. Say hi. You got to poke your head in. There you go. Right there. There we go.
Hey, Matt.
Hey, Tracy.
And she's got a question for you, actually.
Okay.
I have – it's kind of a two-part question.
Oh. You only got one.
So first – what made you think of the @U2 name instead of like U2 fandom or U2 club or U2 roles? And so back then, kind of taking a trip inside your head and figuring out where that came from. And then in today's world, how does that affect the handle that you see all the time?
Are you as happy about the name?
The first part is of the question. I mean, I would love to say that I was brilliant enough to know that Twitter would come along and that the @ symbol would be this international, how we communicate with each other. But it was more just the fact that I was actually thinking of email, is that we were all everybody was @ an email address.
Yeah.
Because it was, Matt @ something. And so, and I wanted a domain that was going to be really, really short. And I didn't want U2.com because the band either had that or I thought they should have that by that point. So I just wanted a short domain. And I love the @ in an email address as an identifier for who you are and what you are and all that sort of stuff. So it just, just kind of seemed normal to do an @ U2 kind of thing. And to answer the second part, it's, I'd be lying if I said it was a great situation, because every time somebody types @ U2, I think it's for us, but it's actually for the band, and now we're @ ATU2, and so there's confusion, but I mean, the band should totally be @ U2 on Twitter. And we should totally be @ ATU2 as we are. And it's a little awkward, but we're dealing with it.
You were a visionary, man. You were a visionary. So your dilemma with the name of the site is a little bit like Bono's dilemma with the name of the band. It's just another commonality. It's just, man, it just fits all the way, Matt. You're just
the struggle is real too.
Yeah, no, that's cool. Yeah, all right. Hey, well, tell us about some of the features, again, for those of you who are just joining, this is, station identification or whatever. Crystal Ballroom here, we're a little chat community around the band U2, which we all love. We don't just love the band, we love the things they do, the messages they send, the music they produce, and all the activism and all that goes with that. And so we're just chatting with Matt McGee. Something I've been wanting to do, I'm feeling like I'm really missing the whole IE tour experience, and I just have to, just kind of like do this kind of thing or something. I need to, like, oh, Matt.
Screenshot.
Oh, Matt. There we go. Yeah. Here, wait. Somebody screenshot. Go ahead, Jerry. Look straight up, Matt. Look up right there. All right, there we go. Is that good enough? All right, we got
spit,
it.
Spit water out.
Oh, wow, water. Here, I got it. No, I don't think I would do that. Yeah, I'm not going to spit. No, it would be me spitting the water out, though.
Pouring water on my keyboard.
Well, that's what I'm thinking here. This is not such a good idea. We can't just replace the LED panels like you two can or something. We don't have Willie here to help us out with the technology of water spitting and all of that. So we wish we did. Willie, you're invited anytime you want. And okay, so where was I? I digress. I've just always wanted to do, you know, that thing right there. So
do the heart.
I'm squeezing you.
Okay, good. All right. We got a tweet from Sherry here. She's going crazy, I think. Oh, she got it. All right. Retweeting that right now. Thank you, Sherry.
Oh, my gosh. Are you making me check Twitter to see what's going on?
Yeah, you might as well go check it. Because thank you, Sherry. All right. Matt. You know. Anyway.
That's great.
Yeah. Okay. So, enough of recreating what we're so terrible at anyway. What are some of the key features kind of on the at site? I mean, we see it as a news site, so obviously that's a major feature. You've got a news. A lot of people don't know even about the news search feature. I don't think. Let's just run through some of the features and just little, you know, short snippets here. What can you tell us about what you're proudest about the site?
Yeah, well, I think that's how a website started, right? Way back in the day was, you know, people, I don't know, when you were young, Tim, did your parents or friends or anybody, like, did they send out, like, newspaper or magazine clippings with YouTube articles?
No, I wish they would have.
Oh, my gosh. Throughout my early married life, my parents, because I live on the West Coast and I have since college, and they live back in Philadelphia.
Very cool.
There'd be something in the Philadelphia newspaper or, you know, whatever magazine they were reading, and they would clip the article out and send it to me. But anyway, that's how the website started, was that in, you know, 95 and 96 and 97, I would just start posting news on the website. Once you start posting news, then more people send you news to post,
right,
and it starts to snowball. And so we have this – at this point, we have a database, you know, of YouTube articles that goes all the way back to 1978.
It's cool.
You can go on to YouTube and go into the news section and use that little search box, and you can see, like, the very first articles ever written about at YouTube in 1978, you know, Evening Press, Hot Press, et cetera, et cetera. So that's probably the thing that, you know, is sort of like what the hub of the website is, and what I'm most proud of is just that – there's this enormous database of, you know, like 8,000 or 9,000 articles that cover YouTube's history from start to present.
So if you're doing, I mean, this really is, thanks for that, Matt, because if you're doing any research, like, we need to encourage that. We need to encourage people to do research. Just type in a word like McPhisto in the search, you know, box there, and you'll get a ton of articles just about McPhisto. You can go way back into the day. So really nice feature. What else? Lately, there's been some developments, I think, too.
Yeah, we used to have two separate websites. We used to have @U2 and U2Tours.com, and it just became too much to sort of, you know, manage two different websites. And so we just figured, let's bring everything under @U2's name. And so we just, you know, like a year or a year and a half ago, just relaunched U2Tours.com at tours.atu2.com. And so that's where all the set lists are, and you can go in and see any show that U2 has ever played and what songs they played and a recap of the concert and reviews from fans and photos. And the cool thing that I like is that you can create like a fan profile, there's tours.atu2.com/profile/Matt McGee, and it lists every show I've been to, every song I've heard, all the photos that I've posted, reviews I've written. It's a really, really cool feature to, because I wouldn't know otherwise that I've seen U2 39 times now, and without that page, I lost count years ago. So
yeah.
it's just a cool kind of thing. And I have to give props. We have a group of like 10 guys and girls that are working on the tour site, and literally looking for live recordings of every show U2 has ever played, and they are night after night after night listening to these live recordings, comparing what they hear to what we have on the website, and correcting and changing and fixing. So when we're done, we've got probably 5 or 6 tours completely finished now, so there's still a lot of work to do. But when we're done, it will be completely and totally 100% accurate based on what has been heard by these folks as they listen to the shows.
I go into the tour section all the time just to try to figure out, you know, where they were in their career and what they were playing and what, you know, you want to search for McGonagall's, man, it's all there, all the gigs way back when. And wow, really cool, really fun to walk through and take a little excursion like that. Yeah, and you just mentioned the At U2 staff. Why don't you say something about, I mean, we had this 20th celebration, and there's so many of us that we couldn't actually all come together. It's a very virtual staff. Many of us have never even met each other. And say something about how the operations all work. I think people might be interested. They know many of the staff, or they follow their tweets or whatever.
Yeah, it's, I don't know, I like to... We have sort of a formal onboarding process, but then it's sort of kind of like, you know, you do your own thing kind of thing is like how I like to envision it. It's very, it's very democratic. I don't, you know, tell everybody what they have to do. We don't have a whole ton of rules or anything like that. We do have, and I mentioned this at the party, you know, we have this 17-page, I think it's 17-page, 17-page document that we send to new staffers when they come on board that just sort of explains how we do things and why we do things and, you know, what is expected and how best to succeed as a part of our team, because we do have a way of doing things.
Yeah.
And you know, one of the things that I say in that document is that it's not my website. It's, you know, I can't stand when, you know, people say, oh, At U2 is Matt McGee's website or whatever like that. It's our website. And so, you know, I told you when you came on board, I want you to feel like this belongs to you. The only time that it's ever my website is when there's legal issues that need to be dealt with. Thankfully, that doesn't come up.
That involved, never happens.
Since my name is legally on the domain, that might happen.
Wow.
When we get letters from lawyers about lyrics being posted or something like that, then I have to deal with that. But it's very much.
Yeah.
You got it.
I want to. It's very much a collective kind of thing, and it's you know, I want people to be, you know, able to have fun. You know, we work hard and we have fun. That's the way we like to do things.
Just start Match McGee Ball. Hey. So one of the things that was cool is that at our celebration, we've one of the staff that works with us is a very good artist, Kelly Eddington. And she's, so if you've ever, if Periscope viewers, if you've ever seen our little feature, Octune, it's called Octune,
Octune.
Yeah, that's a, so, you know, go there and check out, because Kelly's this brilliant, she not only is a wonderful artist, but she's really conceptual about the way she thinks about kind of the quirkiness of U2 that we wouldn't always notice. Well, she created a painting for Matt that really quite stunning, and that's what I was going to ask you about before.
You want me to show it?
Well, you know what? We're going to tweet it out right now. We're going to let people see it. It's really remarkable. It's kind of a representation of everything that Matt has done in 20 years with U2 or is in his office. Yeah, why don't you pull it up on the screen anyway? Tracy's kind of...
It's right there on my wall, so I...
Yeah, move the camera over.
Move my camera over.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, so be right back.
Yeah.
You can still hear me, right?
You could just search it.
No, I can't see, so you're going to have to tell me. Does that show it?
That shows it right there. Hang on. Freeze frame right there, man. So what it's a collage of images of U2 and really kind of the fun life that Matt has had. And we were – are you moving? Yeah, okay. Go ahead. If you want to show us anything particular, you can do that. Oh, Tracy just commented it out in a comment, so you guys can peg on that. Can you do it again? Tell me you copied it. You selected. Matt, are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still here.
All right. Show us a couple of your favorite images in that thing. No, just, yeah, whatever.
I'll come back.
Guys, all you got to do is you do a little Google search for Matt McGee blog. You'll get it. It's a very cool painting. Do we have that tweeted out anywhere? Sherry, get on it, man. Here we go.
I wrote a blog post on my personal blog, which is just go to mattmcgee.com, and it's the very first, the most recent blog post at the top.
Cool, because there's a really that picture is there, and you can get it in high res. It's just gorgeous.
Yeah. She's an incredible artist with a great sense of humor, and what she did is, I mean, like when you guys gave it to me, like it was so dark right in the room were in, so I didn't really get to see it then. And then I brought it home, and I was afraid to look at it because I didn't want to rip it or anything like that.
Yeah.
So I just took it straight to Michael's to get it custom framed.
Nice.
And it just came back. It just came back, you know, like 3 or 4 days ago from getting custom framed. That was the first time I was able to actually, you know, look deeply at it. And I was getting choked up, like looking at how much time she must have put into this. Just blew my mind, and it was, I mean, it's the, you know, just the coolest gift of all time. So, you know, as I said, thank you to Kelly for that, and thank you to the whole At You Two crew for, you know, just everything. I don't deserve anything like that, so.
It's gorgeous, and you do deserve it. And we also need to thank Sherry Lawrence out there.
Yeah, Sherry
spent a lot of time and energy on that piece, and she rocked it. She really did rock it, so. We tease Sherry a lot. She's Irish, and she's got a sense of humor, and boy, she's got spirit to match. She'll let us know if we ever go wrong. So I don't think you can ever fire her again, though, now.
Yeah, I can.
You can still fire. Okay, good. All right, look at it.
That's an inside joke. For folks that don't know, the inside joke is that Sherry has been fired probably 100 times. And she just gets rehired right away anyway, so it's not, I don't even know why I bother.
Yay, Sherry. Okay, hey, are there a few questions out there? Anybody got questions? And we got maybe one more thing to do tonight if we want to take some time with it. I said it could get controversial tonight. It just might do that yet. But we got any questions? Right. We'll do a rapid-fire question kind of a thing here. What fanzines do you read pre-internet, Matt? There were some amazing cartoons and stuff.
I did read fanzines.
Go quick.
I apologize. This was 25 years ago, so I don't remember the names of them, but I did. There were like 3 or 4 that I've subscribed to.
You got any tattoos, Matt?
I do not have any tattoos.
I think Chris and Beth would be on your doorstep if you did. Okay, are we losing a little connection here?
I'm going to look at the Periscope feed for questions,
okay,
right?
Go for it. Yep, go for it. Favorite YouTube collectible?
My favorite YouTube collectible is probably these. So I could do the whole...
Screenshot!
There we go.
Sweet. Look at, we are goofballs, man. We're just waiting
It's harder to read the questions now with these things on.
you blew it. I had another great awe edge shot. Okay, Fly Shades. Okay, No Secret. Cooley's got the Fly Shades. Strangest YouTube collectible.
Strangest YouTube collectible. Okay, hold on.
He's coming back with more, folks.
Okay. I'm not sure if you're going to be able to see this or not. Okay. This was when I was in the mid-80s, I had a job at a record store called Wall to Wall Sound, and this was one of the wall displays from Wall to Wall Sound, the record store, and it's this thick, it's styrofoam, and it's painted in the color, and so I have a whole bunch of YouTube wall displays in my office closet right over there. So that's probably the strangest one. It's like one of a kind, I think. So yeah, that's pretty high up on my list.
I have no idea where he went, so keep talking.
Okay, let me look at the questions. Okay, do I have the inflatable Pop Mart lemon? I do not. I wanted that one, but I never got it.
Do you have a real job, Matt? I saw that question. Do you do this full time?
Do I do what full time?
Do you do at YouTube full time, or do you have a real job? Are you a big boy? Or
what? Oh, yeah, I wish I could do at YouTube full time, but there's no money in at YouTube, so and I have family to support. So no, I have a full time job. I am the editor in chief of two online new marketing news websites, marketingland.com and searchengineland.com. So my cool. day job is in news. It makes sense that I spend my hobby time in news as well.
Yeah, you know what? Matt's really brilliant with all the search engine stuff and all that. So if you ever need a consultant, I'll, you know.
I thank you for saying that, but I don't have time for client work anymore.
Oh, you don't do that anymore, huh? Cool. Okay. Hey, Matt, I need you to put those fly shades on one more time. Can you do that for me? You need a fly shade. Now lean way in, okay?
Oh, you got it.
How's that? Somebody was asking for a little beanie action there. So I don't have any shades here handy, but there you go. All right, we're good. Okay. Hey, Matt. Go ahead.
I love the beanie. That's great. So I saw a question. I didn't see who it was, but they said, have you ever been to the tree? And yes, I've been to the tree, I think, two or three times now. And in fact, we had a fantastic, and I want us to do this again. In 2009, sometime around when YouTube played in Las Vegas, we had about 8 or 10 of our staff, and we drove to the site of the tree.
That's cool.
Some of us had never been there before, and anyway, we have a video on YouTube and tons of photos on our Flickr account. I love going to the tree. I would love to go back again.
That's awesome. Hey, all right, let's do some. Oh, you got another question? Go ahead. Yeah.
No, I think Beth and Bahama said, did we do the plaque? And no, I don't know who did the plaque out of the tree site.
Yeah, it's just great.
Any European shows? No European shows
yet.
Right now, although I continue to look at airfare for every city.
And we hope that Carrie's not watching this right now. No.
Oh, no. She doesn't pay attention.
She doesn't pay attention. I've seen Sean out there a few times. That's kind of fun. Yeah. All right, hey, let's bring it. Okay, you ready to bring it?
I'm ready.
Podcast last week. All right, where are we at right now? You've been getting some hate mail, so let's talk here, Matt. All right. I was listening into the podcast and I heard you say there's a couple of songs on the new album. This is where it's gonna hit the fan, folks. Get ready. I saw some of you tweeting this out earlier, commenting about it. So there's a couple of songs on the Songs of Innocence album that don't go real well with you. I mean, you seem kind of fearless about this, so let's bring it here. Come on.
Alright. Where do you want to start? What do you want to debate first?
Matt, which songs don't you like on Songs of Innocence?
Volcano, Sleep Like a Baby Tonight, Lucifer's Hands.
Oh!
And
it's getting worse. It's getting worse, folks. Crystal Ballroom.
The Crystal Ballroom.
Oh my goodness! There you go. You heard it.
Somebody just said in the chat that I hate hashtag CB. No, no, no. I like hashtag CB because that stands for this. It's the song that I dislike. Let's keep those two things separate, shall we?
One by one. Volcano. What's the deal there? What's going on?
What's the deal with Volcano?
Yeah,
you know what the deal with Volcano is? If you have to declare that you are rock and roll, you are very much not rock and roll, okay?
I wish I could read all the comments going by right now because I'm sure they're just burning up like a volcano. If you have to, okay, so that, you know, I can kind of get that. You know, here's what I see going on in that song, and I got to admit, okay, this is the segment we call Neufeld and McGee Will Never Agree, all right? Because, part of what, you know, okay, but I will give you, I think there's a problem, maybe a small problem. I'm not going to say that I don't dislike anything on the album, really, although I think the problem with the song is more about the mix. And this isn't, you know, maybe going to make a lot of people happy either. what I find happening on this album is there were so many producers that there's a mix that changes throughout the album. And I'm not sure the song Volcano, it's got a really harsh kind of biting edge to it. I can't understand why they mixed Bono's vocals out so far in front of Edge's guitar. I think it's a great rock song myself. I'm just kind of surprised with that and with another song, which we'll talk about in a second, I think the mix could have been better to make the song sound better. Okay, the other thing I would say about Volcano is it's a direct reference to his younger self. I mean, if he's saying you are rock and roll, you and I are rock and roll, I mean, I probably didn't understand that lyric till I seen the show. And he's talking to young Bono. He's talking to this explosive volcano that just lost his mother, that's about to burst all over the place. And he's saying, you know, I and you are rock and roll across the decades here. And so I love it for the sentiment of that. I gotta say that I'm not, when I get to that point in the album, I kind of have to change the mix on my stereo because something is just not meshing for me there. But okay, so not a big fan. How about in concert? Did you like it any better in concert, or
You know, it's the kind of thing that they like Raised by Wolves. I didn't dislike Raised by Wolves on the album, but it was just kind of, you know, okay, it's not, you know, whatever.
Yeah, I agree.
But then when I saw it live,
yeah,
you know, with the full production you know, the meaning and the visuals and all that sort of stuff, then that's when I started to love Raised by Wolves. Volcano hasn't gotten that treatment in the concert. Yeah. I mean, number one, they've only played it, you know, 3 or 4 or 5 times, right?
Yeah,
and number two, they're playing it out on the East Stage, and there's not really any production. There's no, you know, it's just whatever. So it hasn't really had a chance to say, oh, there's more to this song than I think there is.
All right, so Sleep Like a Baby Tonight, just not doing it for you either. In fact, I think I heard you say I skip over that one pretty much every time. It's just an automatic skip. I wish I could take it off the CD.
Cannot bring myself to listen to it.
Oh, my. And is it the tune? Is it the subject? Is it what's going on?
It's not the subject. Yeah. The subject matter is immaterial when I'm deciding if I initially like a song or not. It's just the music, the pace, the falsetto, not good.
So, if Periscope viewers, I don't know what you're doing or how you respond to this. I can't read all the comments, but they don't look pretty, Matt. And, you know, part of what happens on Sleep Like a Baby Tonight, for me, I might be inclined to go that way a little, but we're going to disagree on this one. Partly because on the deluxe album, you've got the alternate version, and those two, see, I'm into all this subtext and underlying meaning, almost probably more so than the actual music of it. So when I hear Sleep Like a Baby Tonight, which is kind of written towards this kind of priestly class that has abused children, and then I hear the alternate version, which is more, it's less cynical, it's more of a comforting lullaby to the child itself who's been abused. Again, my mind's just blown, and I can't just dismiss that. So musically, you know, I think, isn't that Danger Mouse who is really probably, you know, going after just almost, it does feel a little bit like you hit the brakes and you go into something completely different on that song. Is that part of it, or?
That could be part of it. It's very unlike the rest of the songs, which is not bad in and of itself. I mean, there's a lot of songs that are very unlike the rest of U2 albums that I sometimes like, but that one never ever clicked for me.
There's been a lot of people asking for that one in concert. That's probably one of the top requests that I've heard, you know, or when are you going to play, you know, Soldier, and when are you going to play Sleep Like a Baby Tonight.
We have the poll question on our homepage right now is, which of those two songs do you hope gets played?
Yeah.
And it's only going to be on, I'm going to change that in the next day or two since the tour's about to start, but I'm shocked. It's like, there it is, Sleep Like a Baby Tonight. 46% want to hear Sleep Like a Baby Tonight. 54% want to hear This Is Where You Can Reach Me Now.
Yeah, that's pretty close. I'm kind of surprised at that too. I think the subject content of Sleep Like a Baby Tonight is so jarring and so out of the topic that they're working on kind of in the tour. I doubt we'll see that one.
I agree with you 100% on that.
We agree. All right. Lucifer's hands. Come on. Okay, go for it. Lucifer's hands. The stingray guitar.
It's just neither here nor there for me.
Yeah. Okay.
It's just.
It doesn't do anything.
It's a B side. It's a bonus track. I think it's that appropriate. I don't think it is an album. It's not that I hate it or detest or anything. It's just it does not do anything for it.
Lucifer's hands for me. Okay, so you're giving me all this content for my next At You Too article right now. And part of what...
yes! Wait for that article.
Yeah, so part of what it does for me... who was it? AJ, I think, or U2 Wanderer tweeted, what's favorite lyrics the other day? And I just said, oh, part of the lyric set for me that works so well is, you know, and... someone has to take control, or someone else is in control out of the troubles, and then you move right into Lucifer's hands. See, I'm always talking subtext and all this stuff again. And in Lucifer's hands, you get you're no longer in control of me. And I think the two are pretty intentional to be a set one after the other. I would love to see those two in concert together. That would be really fun. But man, Matt, not so much. Crystal Ballroom? Crystal Ballroom, the song, of course.
This is where, like, everybody on the feed is going to get really upset with me. So, I mean, you guys, like, there were so many people that loved that song, and I tried so hard to get into Crystal Ballroom and listen to it time and time and time again, and I can't get into that song. Do you know what? Okay, so I'll say this at the risk of you guys never being able to hear this song the same way again, okay?
Uh-oh. La, 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 la. Nobody's hearing nothing. La, la, la. Okay. Plug your ears if you don't want to hear this. This is like worse than spoiler content right here. Go ahead, Matt.
So Crystal Ballroom to me sounds like it was left over from the Spider-Man soundtrack.
Oh.
Because it has many of the same sort of choral elements and... sort of, it sounds Broadway-ish to me. That in itself is not bad, because I like the Spider-Man soundtrack. I like the song, most of the songs on that, and I saw the Spider-Man production, the musical, in New York, I think, 3 or 4 times, and liked that as well. It sounds like it was a leftover, and they weren't sure what to do with it, and all this, and so I apologize. I know you guys love that song, but...
Well,
I've tried so hard and just cannot get into it.
So I gotta admit, now I really do like the song. It was one of the first songs that I liked on the deluxe set, really. Like, I just thought, why did they leave this song off the main album? But, you know, considering it probably doesn't... Actually, it does fit. It's talking about McGonagall's. It's talking about the Crystal Ballroom. But the funny thing was, when I was at Boston 3 and we were standing right next to the E stage, and Bono is going into his bit about, this is one of our most requested songs and our family loves this and our crew loves this and we're going to do it for them. And I'm standing right next to the E stage. All of a sudden, people start tweeting me, they're going to do it, Tim. They're going to do it. They're going to do the Crystal Ballroom. It's like, oh my goodness. Wow. Is that really my identity now or what? And I like it. I liked it from the E stage, but it's not a big power song. I think they stopped doing it for a reason. It just doesn't actually work very well in concert. And I said from the beginning, I didn't think they would do it in concert, because it's got to have two edges and it's got to have two guitars to actually make it work. And it's pretty hard to carry in concert, especially from the E stage. But fun to watch, and I'm glad they did it. Probably the most fun of that evening was watching Larry start the wrong song. He was starting, I think it was, he was starting Crystal Ballroom, and he was supposed to be doing Angel of Harlem or vice versa or something like that. But that was pretty fun, too. Thank you, Larry. That was a good one. He kind of looked down, and I'll never forget Larry just looking straight down at his set list and just going, oh, shit, you know, that kind of thing. It was hilarious. And then kind of looking out, my wife got this great picture of him just looking straight kind of out at us with this really confused face. Favorite for you? What's a favorite song for you on the album?
From the new album?
Yeah.
I mean, it was California for the longest time, but then once they started playing Cedarwood Road in concert, it's when I'm getting my car and I'm going to the store or whatever, or just running a quick errand, yeah. Cedarwood Road is the first one I go and listen to.
Yeah. See, and California, I was initially drawn to that too, and I would tell you, that's the song that I wish could be a rock tune on the album. I think that tune has such great potential. Part of what disappointed me, I don't know, disappointment's a little strong word. I'm not as passionate about these things as you are, but it got all adult contemporary out with these, you know, kind of these lofty synth kind of tracks over the top of it. And what I was hoping for is I was hoping they were going to bring it to concert with just one of these wild edge guitar moments. And it kind of didn't happen. I wonder if that's why they stopped playing that song too. I really thought they were going to do that song in California. We just didn't see it. We saw it, what, in Vancouver once and San Jose once, I think. Was there a Phoenix or something? But it just hasn't been played that much either.
I'm looking at it right now, actually. Vancouver 2.
Yeah.
The first show in Los Angeles.
That was.
And the Roxy Theater show. That's the only three times. Yeah. Oh, and the show I was at in Chicago. So three times on tour plus the Roxy show were the only times it's full. So
I think it's a great song. I just, again, I kind of wonder about the mix of the thing, and I wish it could have been a real rock tune. That would have been fun. Edge has this wild guitar album still buried deep within him, and I can't wait for it to come out.
For me, it's a great song for driving fast on the freeway. So
it gets you going, but with a good rock guitar, it could just be even better. It could be a lot of fun. The funny thing about California is I think I heard Bono say something to the effect that it's about the happiest sad song they've ever done. It's pretty deep content again.
Yeah.
And I'm from California, so I can really relate to this theme of it being kind of this wanderer just chasing the glitz and the glamour of Hollywood and the dream of Southern California. Well, the reality of it is, you know, Hollywood is filled with teenage runaways who come and they're looking for kind of this dream life, and it just doesn't work out. And that's what the song's about. So I really appreciate the theme of the song too.
Part of my attraction to the song is that I went to college at Pepperdine, which is in Malibu,
Sweet.
California, right along the Pacific Coast Highway.
Yeah.
And so just that whole visual of, you know, which is just south of Santa Barbara. And so, you know, in college, I spent, you know, a fair amount of time driving up to Santa Barbara and, you know, going to basketball games there, volleyball games, and just hanging out in that whole coastal scene.
Yeah.
So, I admit that that's, you know, a big part of the attraction for me is that it very much captures that vibe and sound and feeling. So I think that probably plays into, you know, one of the reasons that I loved it from the beginning.
Yeah, cool. All right, you want to hear the one, my least favorite on the album?
Yes, I do.
This might tick
Turn
a few
the table
people
on
off.
Yourself.
Yeah, this might tick a few people off. You want to take a guess?
Your least song?
Yeah.
I think you might know. I think it's Every Breaking Wave.
Yeah, I just don't have, it doesn't do anything for me.
I
think there's some nice lyrics in it. One of my favorite lyrics on the album, you know, it's hard to listen while you preach. But I just, you know, Every Breaking Wave, I call it my bathroom song. When this concert is streaming, it's right there in the middle of the concert. I got to run. I got to go use the bathroom. I get a bottle of water, a snack, and I'm back in by the time it's over. It's a beautiful moment.
Tim, is it because they're doing the stripped down version with just the piano?
Yeah. Well, it's a great adult contemporary tune again. I mean, it's a great AC tune. It almost sounds like it was produced on the album to be that AC tune. And the thing that's happening again with the mix is it's just a different mix than many of the other songs on the album. So it feels like it had a different producer again. But it's, I mean, thematically, poetically, it's really a great tune. And I think it's, you know, it's the cigarette lighter moment of the concert, right? So everybody gets out their, you know, their phones, and it can really be a beautiful moment, and I've loved it while I'm there in person. I just call it my every bathroom wave song, and I just run and use it quick because it's right in the middle of the show.
I would love to hear the full band version in concert. I think the version they do is beautiful, but yeah. I think for me, the album version, I agree with you that there is a bit of, you know, maybe overproduction and sort of, you know, production by numbers, and let's turn this one into a radio hit. I think that's certainly part of it, but I still think it's one of the most beautiful things they've ever written. You know, top 25. It's the album version I really, really love to listen to.
Yeah. Good. Well, that's interesting. What do you think of Song for Someone and all the kind of new publicity again? I have Sirius XM in my car, and I have YouTube programmed in to, you know, show up whenever they're on a channel. And my goodness, this thing comes on several times an hour right now. It's on all different stations. So any thoughts on Song for Someone and what's going on with that?
Well, number one, my wife has Sirius XM, and you're going to have to teach me and her how to do that programming.
Okay.
Because I didn't know you could do that.
Well, it's my radio. Maybe it doesn't do it on yours, I guess. There's some alerts that you can set, and yeah, it just shows me whenever YouTube comes on. So. Right now, it's Octune Baby, Beautiful Day, and Song for Someone. I mean, those are the ones that, you know, come up all the time.
Yeah, I'm kind of surprised that, I mean, Song for Someone, I think, is, you know, obviously a beautiful radio-friendly song as well.
Yeah.
I kind of thought that Every Breaking Wave would get that much attention when it was released, but it obviously didn't.
Yeah. So we got some new video out this week, and I like the video. I think it's really true kind of to the spirit and the theme of the song, and I think it's got some great thematics in it. One thing I just realized, and I tweeted out the other day, I think Karen Lindell helped me figure this one out, is that it's actually being played on that Jimmy Fallon show in May. So that says something about production and marketing and timing and all of that to me as well.
Yeah, it's interesting how they had the long form, you know, the mini film, and now they have this new video, and it's interesting to me to watch how the promotion of a song and the marketing of a song it has to be done in this day and age compared to how it was done, you know, 20 years ago, where you just get one music video and the big push, and that was, see how far it goes.
Little different than Gloria on MTV, right? Back in the day.
That's right.
When they were breaking MTV wide open with Gloria and a few others then, too. And then you have the Woody Harrelson mini film, which it's almost so understated and so subtle you miss it, but I think there's a pretty good kind of piece of videography there going as well too. I like that one.
Yeah, I agree with you.
And so you kind of have these layers. I mean, you've got this kind of soul searching black and white video in Anton Corbin, you know, kind of fashion that came out this last week. You've got The Prisoner released from jail in the Woody Harrelson version. You've got Bono saying in concert it's a love song for Allie, who he's still trying to impress, or his daughters. And then you've also got the interaction with the screen going on, which is him kind of talking to his younger self, you know, don't let it go out, and trying to encourage and push on the young Bono through the tragedy and the pain of that universe in his bedroom that went cold and losing his mother. In my mind, it is the quintessential U2 song, because it serves on all of those different layers and those levels. And there's a religious theme going through it as well, when you kind of have this language about Hill of Calvary, and in the video you see a light up on a hill and that kind of thing. So it's just, it really is, it's the first song that grabbed my attention on the album as being quintessential U2. I mean, this is the stuff that carries U2 into the next decade even, I think.
Yeah, the most recent, the black and white video that, you know, the one that was just released, it was surprising to me that it didn't play on the themes that are touched on in the concert. I was expecting it to be more of an obvious relationship type thing, and it's very much not that. So I think it's a video that, you know, kind of deserves and maybe even requires repeated viewing to sort of see what's going on. And you pointed, I think it was you pointed out on Twitter or an email, and I had the same thought too at the end with the sort of the blurry figures, very reminiscent of the passersby for Moment of Surrender on the screen and all that sort of stuff. It's and I saw somebody on Twitter point out how I think it's early in the new video that Bono's on the ground, much like he was on the ground in what was it the. At the end of the state, right?
Yeah, so JT, actually, he put a little compilation. JT's out there from Costa Rica. He gave me a little collage of pictures of Bono on the ground. I mean, yeah, there are several videos where Bono ends up on the ground, as well as recent bike accidents and that kind of thing.
Maybe that's what it's a reference to.
I doubt it. We're making way too much of that. All right, Matt, well, probably time to wrap it up. You got anything you want to leave us with or final thoughts here?
Well, first, thanks for having me in here and on, and I apologize to all the Crystal Ballroom friends who I offended with my with my lack of appreciation for that song. Can I mention the thing that we're posting on At U2 tomorrow?
Yeah, this is gorgeous. Yeah, you definitely need to. And I was actually going to ask a couple questions about that, but do that, please. Yeah.
So tomorrow we're going to it's gone through the editing process and it's been approved by the staff. And so tomorrow we're having a little interview with Willie Williams that we're going to post on At U2. I don't know what time, maybe lunchtime, Pacific time, when I can take a break from my day job. And so we just asked him, you know, a bunch of questions about what happened on the first leg, and so, you know, what does he think about, you know, what's going on with fans and all this sort of stuff, and then tried to get some information out of him about changes that we could expect on the second leg. He revealed what, Tim? You know, one or two little things, but there was also, you know, a few references to, you know, I can't give away the secrets. So it's he didn't answer all the questions that I would have loved him to answer, but it's, I think it's still, you know, going to be a good read for people.
Well, yeah, and I think, well, we just won't say anymore. I love his, Willie Williams is so brilliant, and he's articulate at the same time, and that's what's really fun about this article coming out. And a couple of the questions that I threw at you are related to what we're doing here. They're related to streaming and live technology and things like that. So it'd be fun for, we won't say anything tonight, it'll be just fun for our readers to get into that article. We could probably run a Crystal Ballroom episode just on that article when people are through reading it. It'll be a fun one.
I was actually thinking about doing a hangout of some sort tomorrow night to talk about it. So maybe
do
maybe,
it.
Yeah, maybe we'll do something tomorrow night.
Yeah, you should. That'd be great. And we got podcasts coming as well. New podcasts online.
Yeah, Chris Enns is doing such a fantastic job. I think I saw Chris. He's at iChris. I think I saw him.
Yeah, he's here.
Earlier. He's doing such a fantastic job sort of organizing the podcast and all the production. And so, yeah, it's, you know, every week. And you're on this week, aren't you?
I don't know that yet. I volunteered. We'll see. Or maybe I missed it. I haven't been back to check on a few things. One of the innovations there that we're thinking about is maybe some live chat going on during the podcast, so people could actually listen to it. Not this week yet, but people could actually listen to us record the podcast and interact, chat, and ask questions again, much in the same fashion.
Yeah, exactly. It'd be similar to the atmosphere that's going on here, where people can talk as, you know, listen in as we record, comment on what is being discussed on the podcast and ask questions and all that sort of stuff. So, yeah, there's some cool ideas planned.
All right, cool. Well, folks, let's...
You gotta promote your stuff coming up in November.
Okay, well, let's say something about that. Yeah, I do want to do that, and thanks for the reminder. We've got the little Crystal Ballroom people here, the magic people behind the mirrors or whatever. You know, it's grown into something that I never would have imagine, and all you folks are so wonderful and kind. And a couple of the folks, Jeff Long and Susan Navakian, they have been working at putting a meetup together So we're going to have a meetup right here in Fresno, California. It's in the center of California, right in between Los Angeles and San Francisco. And we're still working on the details. We've secured some lodging at a local hotel. We're going to have a gathering. We're going to kind of take over a restaurant. And on November 14th, we're going to watch the Paris show on HBO. So that's going to be a lot of fun to do together as a community. We're still working on a couple other surprises. So if any of you want information on that in advance, we're kind of just making it available to the Crystal Ballroom folks right now. We have an address that Jeff has started. That's at YouTube. I'm sorry, it's not at. It's, yeah, see, even I get mixed up with you. It's U2CrystalBallroom@gmail.com. So U2CrystalBallroom@gmail.com. Or you can follow on Twitter at U2Ballroom. Or you can search it out on Facebook. But Jeff and Susan, thank you so much. I can't believe the work that you guys have gone to. And I'm really just going to be a guest. I'm just going to be attending and hang out and have fun. And Music Girl, we got shirts coming too. We're working on that design, and we're definitely going to have them available and ready to go with the Crystal Ballroom for that weekend. So thanks for thanks for prodding me and keep asking on that one, all right? So great job, Matt. Thanks for being with us. You can pick this up on Catch. Just search for Tim Neufeld, and you can go get the Catch thing at YouTube Ballroom on Twitter. Thank you, Matt. That's decent of you. Yeah, they're not quite getting the whole thing, but they got the idea. Thank you. And I'll put this conversation up on our YouTube channel, which we call the Crystal Ballroom. You can search it out. It's got the interview with YouTube Brother on there. Thanks, Mark, for being with us tonight. I saw you out there. It's got the interview with Beth and Chris. Thanks, guys. I saw you out there. It's got the interview with Big Wave. And I think we're coming to the close of our interview season because we've got a show coming right away, don't we, folks? I don't even remember exactly when. Is it Friday night? Come next Friday in Turin. Is that what we're...
Yep.
Okay. And so we'll be trying to, all of you folks out in Europe, hey, help us out, man. I already saw Paco. Paco Elevation, he's going to be in Paris, and he's already told me I'm going to stream. And so, we'll be looking for some of those feeds and help us out if you're going to be there in Europe. We'd love to hang out with you for once. We got to do it in the middle of the day, I guess, huh?
Okay. Yeah, it's Friday morning for you and me, right?
Noonish or something like that. Yeah.
Italy is 9 hours ahead.
9 hours. There you go. Okay. Yeah, you're right. So I guess what I was thinking is if we try to do a Periscope, people keep asking me, are we going to keep the Crystal Ballroom going? I don't know yet, folks. I got a real job too. I teach and during the day. So we'll see what happens. Maybe if anything, I'm sure we'll at least do an evening chat and just try to hear what everybody's thinking. But all right, I'm fading. Can you tell I'm getting tired? It's been a long day, but this has been absolutely fantastic. Thank you, Matt, for being here. We're going to say goodnight from the Crystal Ballroom. Everybody, tell us where you're from tonight. We want to see locations here. Where's everybody from? Somebody earlier today was asking me, do we have any other California people? And I said, well, we'll comment on some locations here. We'll do a shout out. A roll call for location. So everybody kick in on our way out here. We got Miami and Chicago and LA and on and on and on. And here we go. We are out tonight. Nice. Bye, Matt.
Thanks,
Tim. All right. Good night, brother. Talk to you soon.
See you, bud.
All right. How was that? Was that good? Thanks, guys, for stopping by. We'll do a little light bulb here. One of my favorite songs right here. Sorry, Matt. What happened? I don't know. Technology. I'm not very good at it. Good night, everybody. Thanks for stopping by in our crazy little ballroom.